and good talent on display. This is a Clarendon represented with these two teams, and like I said earlier, that parish has a wealth of talent and a very good youth system. And so we expect that, especially as well today, we expect it also to be fierce. We saw that Coach Thomas, he made the move over to Lennon from Clarendon, and so that could add a little spice to this contest today.
Well, he did make the move last year. I'm not sure how much spice it added to the contest last year based on the results, Dwight.
Well, as I said, with the exodus of so many players from Clarendon, I do expect it to be a closer contest this time around. There were 12 goals in the two games between the two teams last season, of which Lennon only contributed one. I expect him to do better this season. And that expectation comes because, as I said before, they have retained, and I look at the starting lineup, 8 of their players from last season.
And we're off here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex for the opening game of the schoolboy football season 2019. And as I mentioned before, Lennon in the orange and blue, and the Clarendon College in the black and yellow. Not sure if there's the away kit or it's a third kit, but a number of these teams have their own personal sponsors where they can be decked out in colors of your choosing, really. But Lennon starting off sprightly in the opening moments of this one. Alfonso Johnson, you just saw him here. He's playing in the left back position, but he's not afraid to go forward. Jaime Hall. Well, they lose it out in the middle of the park, and Clarendon College will try and come the other way. Andre Nicholson. Of course, Nicholson, the scorer of that goal in the Oliver Shields final last year against Kingston College, having come on as a substitute. The big guns weren't firing in that match. Nicholson came on to score one of the best goals of the season last year at the National Stadium.
Very often we say to players on the bench that you have to stay in tune with the game because the winner could be on the bench.
Well, he's staying tuned to the game, Lenny High, the technical director. Clarendon College. They've sat back just a little bit as Lennon tried to express themselves. Oh, was he clipped outside the box? Has he pointed to the spot?
It appears he has pointed to the spot. Initially, it looked like it was...
No, but it was outside the box, I'm sure.
It definitely looked so.
But he has pointed to the spot for a penalty. Has he? Or has he changed his mind?
He has, the Clarendon College player. I'd have to have a look at that one again.
Initially, I thought that was actually outside the box, but it's going to be a penalty to Clarendon College. And it's going to be Richard King to take it, one of their centre-backs, to put the Lacoste Cup champions ahead. Richard King scores 1-0 to Clarendon College over Lennon. Lennon started off confidently in this one, but it's an early strike by CC in the third minute. Puts them ahead here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex.
And as we saw with the build-up to that penalty being awarded, it was the fullback who overlapped. And as we said earlier, in the modern game, the fullback is definitely a potent weapon. And that penalty was put away with aplomb.
Well, 1-0 to Clarendon College over Lennon High. I reckon that it's too early to say it's as you were in this contest.
The signs are ominous, though. But initially, it looked like it was outside the box. But obviously, the referee was closer to the action, deemed it was in.
Bajan would have seen this all before as coach of Lennon. in the first game last year, which they lost 5-1. He lost a couple of players early because of injury in that matchup. In the second game, which they lost 6-0, a number of the reserve players were in that game after they had qualified for the knockout stage of the Da Costa Cup, decided to rest a few players, and Clarendon College went all out. Well, based on the results, Lennon with the free kick, three-man wall set up, and that's high. No problems there for Prince Daniel Smith.
If there's any silver lining in the cloud here for Lennon, is that the goal was scored in the third minute of play, so they have all of 87 minutes to come back. And good signs were seen by the Lennon players when the penalty was awarded. We saw them going to each other and saying, let's go again. So the heads have not fallen.
And that's one of the things that we heard in the feature as they looked ahead to this game, that if they concede, they have to keep their heads up. They have to go against adverse conditions and make sure that they stand up to the defending champions.
Well, obviously Coach Thomas's message did get across, because we did see in their body languages that they are going to definitely keep going.
Long throw taken by Ashley. Clarendon College trying to clear their lines through David Chambers. It's going to be an interesting battle across there between Alfonso Johnson and Jamari Howell. Ball played up front, not quite through, as a challenge came in strong from Gawain Austin. Granville trying to beat his marker, can't. Granville again, after being fed by Omar Reed.
And it just all looks a little bit too easy in the opening, going for Clarendon College to get into the defensive third of this Lennon team. And you would want more of work coming from your midfield to try and prevent them getting into that defensive third so easily.
Reed with the throw. Nicholson collects, trying to go along that byline, was looking for the corner, didn't get it, came off him last, and it's going to be a goal kick to Lennon. Again, the spirits are still up despite the fact that they trail Lennon high.
That's a good sign. It's always a good sign as a coach on the sideline to see that your players are still willing to put in the fight, and the heads don't drop too early.
Be easy for Clarendon College to defend. And they give up the throw. Not the best touch there from their veteran centre back, Earl Simpson, there at the back for Clarendon College.
I was about to say, it's not so far in the game, it's not the silky smooth moves and touches from this Clarendon College team. But in the opening game, 3 points is most important.
Well, Lennon really hustling as they try to get the shot on target. Deschanel Campbell with the effort that was charged down. Here they come again, long distance effort is wide of the target. And he's telling his players, just keep up. That was Leon Glaives. Coming from Heidel High, Leon Glaives, and you heard his mother speak before the start of the game. So wherever he goes, she's gonna always be with him, whether he's playing at Heidel or now for Lennon High. We're the number 8 for Lennon High, Leon Glaives.
I think one thing too for this Lennon team, for them to keep their heads up, they would not have seen anything here with this Clarendon College team in the early goings that would suggest to them that they don't have a chance of staying in this game and possibly getting something from it.
That's Yafael Thompson. He's also another Kingstonian playing for a Clarendon team, having made his way from Mona High, the number 20, for Lennon.
With the advent of the highway, it's not a far journey.
No, it's not. It's not at all. And we'll soon say the same about St. Thomas and Portland in a couple of years.
And those places seem to be off the island sometimes.
That should be a goal kick.
But I was saying in the first set of games, it's always about the 3 points for the coaches. You don't probably expect your team to be firing on all cylinders. There's nerves, there's a little bit of anxiety. The 3 points is most important. And in a zone with only 4 teams, you want to be ahead early.
Throwing to Lennon. You can see Clarendon College pressing a little bit higher as the game has progressed, and getting a goal helps with the confidence as well, as they try to play the ball around a little bit more.
Well, a goal always helps to settle a team, and they know they're ahead, so they can settle into their playing style. And the feature of the pressing high, it was really a feature of Clarendon last season. And even in the finals, when they went down to 10 men, they still executed that game plan quite well.
Lennon just losing the ball in the attacking third, and Clarendon College coming away with the possession now, trying to get out of the middle of the park and can't do so. There's a whistle on the play. Free kick to Lennon High.
I think what Lennon has to do too, as we can see in the middle of the park, just a little bit too close that triangle with the 3 players in there. You want to have at least, you know, at 8-10 yards, and then you can pass between the lines and your passes make headway rather than the pass and you're almost in the same area.
Oh, here's a big chance for Lennon! 1-1! They have come roaring back in this contest! And was it Alfonso Johnson who fired that one? In the attacking third from the left back position, who knew? In his 4th season, he leads by example. And in the 13th minute of play, Clarendon College 1, Lennon High 1.
As we said, what we've seen, Lennon would not be scared of this Clarendon College team. It always seems like they were going to be in it. And again, that was a good finish. He went across, tried to go across goal there. It was a good finish.
It really was Alfonso Johnson there with the finish. And Prince Daniel Smith, would he be disappointed with his attempt there?
And they always say it for the goalkeeper at the near post, but that one hit the post. It was as far away from the goalkeeper as he could have gone and still scored. It was a good finish, but yes, goalkeepers are always disappointed with that. But again, what we saw in that goal was that the Clarendon defense just shifted a little too much, and in getting to the ball side, just left too much room on the far side.
Well, here's Clarendon College looking to go ahead once more. There are players inside the box, and it's collected in the end by Javon Grant.
Seemed like there was a lack of communication there because both players got into each other's way.
Lennon not showing any nerves at all in this one, and they come speeding along the left-hand side. And Prince Daniel Smith will be happy that he was able to collect that one easily as Granville trying to settle things down for Clarendon College, and it's Leonard doing all the hustling at the moment. Forced to get out of their own half. Jamari Howell.
You always hear the whole cliche, a goal changes everything, and that goal certainly has put some spring in the steps of the Lennon players.
Clarendon College, well, surely they've got the message now that they have to work hard to get the better of this Lennon High team, because they won't roll over and die, although all their players rolling over on the pitch and need some attention from the sidelines.
Not all of them, just one. But yes, we expected it to be a much closer contest this season, and reason being that Clarendon, you know, they've lost a lot of players and their talismanic players have gone out, and Lennon, as we said, retained at least 8 of their players. So we expect it to be close, and it is so far in the game. But mind you, one of the game last season ended 5-1 in favour of Clarendon. So we may not speak too early.
I think I saw one of the players suffer from cramp there. One of the Lennon High players. There's Leon Laves cooling down. At some point, we're going to look back at what took place with the penalty, and if it was actually inside the box where the challenge was made. My initial thought that it was outside the box.
The only thing that I could say is that I didn't see much of a protest from the Lennon players on that one, but we'll have a look at it. But despite that, the Lennon players were able to find the resolve to come back in this one. And as it stands, it is 1-1. And they're right in this contest.
Of course, one of the new rules in football is that you can actually play to another player when you're doing a goal kick. And he's inside your area, your own penalty area. Ball over the top for Lennon, and the flag has gone up for offside. Indeed it has.
And previously that rule used to, you have to, the ball would have to exit the penalty, the 18-yard box. And some argue whether or not it is advantageous to defenders or attackers. Some say it invites the pressure closer to your goal. While others may say that you are able to draw the pressure in and be able to play beyond the pressure over or around it and exclude players from the game. But I guess it's which side of the coin you tend to look at it on.
I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit, Dwight, and I wanted to just think about it for a while, but Lennon not playing with a traditional 4-4-2 as they send this one inside the box and it goes behind for a goal kick. Especially when they're transitioning, when they're trying to attack. The way that they're moving forward and how their number 7 gets involved with the play. Trying to decipher the method that they're using. Originally, he was named to be a left back, the Lennon High number 7, Alfonso Johnson. But he's gone further up the field. Still on the left-hand side for Lennon. And he's actually making a nuisance of himself on that left-hand side. Clarendon College not being able to handle him at the moment. Jaheim Hall is covering that area on the left-hand side of defense. Oh, that's beautifully done. He waited on it and it didn't get to him. And so Clarendon College trying to capitalize. Nicholson trying to dink it over the top to Roderick Granville. Now this is Omar Reed running into some trouble.
I think the concept that I think has been deployed here by the Lennon team is that, as we said earlier, a player's coming from deep are potent weapons in the modern game, because nobody tends to mark a player deep into the game. And so he arrive as a surprise, always in attack. And as such, he comes in unmarked, unnoticed. And like we saw on the goal there, he had acres of space on that left-hand side to execute his shot.
Well, he's now on the right-hand side, the number seven for Lennon, the orange, young Alphonso Johnson.
But you do that at times as coaches. You have your wide players, wide strikers, wide midfielders. You ask them to change their point of attack and give the defending team a lot to think about. So when the defender is up against this player and thinks he has worked it out, then he has something else to deal with. So football is about deception and trying to surprise your opponent. And I think the Lennon team in their transition has been doing well.
Well, the Lennon players know the system that they're playing, that's for sure. Because as we said, Johnson is now in a right back area. As Lennon, they have the free kick in their own half.
Well, the key thing as coach is that you tell your players, whatever system you're playing, it does not mean that a particular player will have to stay in that position for 90 minutes. But as long as the team shape is there for the most of 90 minutes, then that's what the coach wants. But football is a fluid game, and you expect that you keep your shape whichever player finds themselves in that position.
Just confirmed that a yellow card actually went to Leon Glaives. Missed that one.
Didn't see for what offense that one was given.
Granville over on the right hand side, trying to play it inside to Nicholson. Searching ball. Defenders have a lot of work to do.
On that occasion, I think he trusted his goalkeeper, but the ball was not rolling as fast enough for the goalkeeper to collect. And you want your defender to be decisive in those moments. Just deal with it and get your team to regroup. The teacher here has a lot of things to think about, as his team not seemingly creating much distance between themselves and this Lennon team. Consultation there from the officials. If they're thinking about the break for water, well, here we have it.
We're just about to mention the scorching heat here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex, and here we have the first official water break just about midway the first half.
The referees are right on cue.
Yeah, it was inside the box. And the spot kick converted.
And there we saw the defense of Clarendon just shifted a little too much to the right side in order to cover the ball side and protect the middle. And the defender did not transition fast enough to go and close down the Johnson. And he finished beautifully. And on that goal, I think on the replay, we saw where the player fell in the box. But, you know, it's where the initial contact was made. It's just maybe later on we can see it further back where the initial contact was made. Because if it was outside the box and he fell in the box, it's
still where it should be outside the box.
Exactly.
Right.
He's getting some attention now, Javon Grant.
Captain of Lennon High.
Yeah, last season he was the reserve goalkeeper to Bird. But he has certainly stepped up to the first team and also stepped up to a leadership position. They often say the goalkeeper, he has the remote with all the buttons for all the players. And the good thing with those goalkeepers too is not about their ability to stop shots or block them, but to prevent them from coming. And as such, to be good at organizing the players in front of them. So a very vocal goalkeeper is always good.
A number of the Lennon High players coming through the system. And so they would know each other. Nicholson. Haven't seen a whole lot from Andre Nicholson in this game so far. Larmond looking for options.
That might be credit to the Lennon team. They've really been closing down high up the pitch.
They've been hustling and bustling in this heat. The teams. So Lennon High would be looking at the clock and they'll be congratulating themselves, saying so far so good.
It's still only 27 minutes.
So far so good. They have been plugging the gaps, haven't they?
They've been making it very difficult for this Clarendon College team. We spoke about it earlier, where it was just too easy for Clarendon to get into their defensive.
That's almost a delightful ball. Almost.
But it was almost too easy for them to get in. But now Lennon is making it a lot more difficult for Clarendon.
Granville's kipping by a challenge. Haven't seen a lot from Zakia Wilkes as well, the number 22 for Clarendon College. And if you want to know who has big shoes to fill, it would be him. There he is on the ball.
I would venture to pluralize that. Shoes. More shoes.
Shoes and socks.
Yes. Because definitely Lamar Walker and Daly are just huge, huge players for him to try and emulate.
Funny thing is, both of them could have played this year. They were young enough.
Yeah, but I've seen where Roberto are looking for higher and greener pastures.
Yep. Professional contracts.
And that is the way to go. If you are elite, really and truly, the Costa Cup and the Manny Cup should be second choice.
Definitely. And they often said that it's in Jamaica that you find out we're discovering talents at 16 and 17. In other countries, those talents are playing in the highest leagues around the world. So I totally agree. If they can grace those stages pretty early, then it's always good for them.
Kyler Williams now needs some attention from the bench. Holding his lower back. Probably just got a knock there.
But despite a player down there, I think Coach Thomas would be quite pleased with his charges so far in this game.
Got a knock in his back.
Yeah, look,
the ice was applied to the wrong place, though, I think. but I'm sure the coolness will spread.
Yes, from one point to the other. But they say ice works miracle for these players.
They just want
to apply it, and they're good to go. And hence the advent of the magic spray.
It's all Robitussin. Needs a good cross inside the box. If he can get by his marker, which he can't, not legally anyway, it's going to be a free kick to Clarendon College.
And that was the left back, I think, Williams, who needed to get that cross in the box, was it? From Lennon?
Well, technically the left midfield, but they are literally all over the place.
And that was quite disappointing, I think, after his second cutting back of the football. It was a clear chance to get it into the box. And I think Lennon will need to take the opportunities when they get into the final third for this Clarendon College team.
In an interview with us, as we looked ahead to Lennon's preview this season, Coach Thomas was saying that his philosophy, as we see Lennon trying to bear through and goal, this could be a second. Oh, there was not a lot of power behind it. But before he managed to take the shot, he was actually pulled, I believe, but he didn't go to the turf. There he is, just slightly pulled back, but he didn't go to the turf, and then not a lot of power behind the shot, and he was really disappointed in the end.
I think the referee did well there, played the advantage, just to see if he could have executed. He was under no pressure after that. He had time to settle and pick a spot either side of the goalkeeper. So that was good refereeing there in allowing the advantage.
Jerome Williams so close to getting his first this season. But yeah, not a lot of power behind it.
And those are the situations where you want Lennon being the underdog in this rivalry over the years to take advantage.
So I was making a point about Coach Thomas and his days at Clarendon College as coach working under Lenny Hyde, that his philosophy wasn't accepted at Clarendon College, so he had to leave. Of course, he says that there are no hard feelings with his departure. But based on what we're seeing here this afternoon, his experiments and how he has rotated his players during the game, it would be interesting to see how that would have been accepted elsewhere. But Lennon has embraced this style, and he has so much confidence in his players to actually pull it off.
I think it's always, as players, young coaches coming through. I mean, you want to impose your style on your team. And I think it's just a case where I think Thomas wants to go and carry out his philosophy. And it would have been good. I mean, the players have to be, it's not an easy thing to do and to stay concentrated and carrying out your task, but he has certainly done well in getting these players to accept and execute his style of play.
Long ball delivered inside the box, looking for Granville. It was at the back post. Roderick Granville wasn't tall enough to get there, but he was sandwiched by a couple of players.
Yeah, it was difficult for him. But on the point of Thomas again as well, I think I'm quite sure it's correct when he said there's no hard feeling in it. Football is a dynamic game, different style. It's not that one style works better than the other. It's always executed.
But it's a complicated process, what we're seeing here, what Lennon trying to do, right?
It can be if players are not in tune with it. But like I said earlier, it's the shape that which is most important. As long as you can maintain your shape, the team that maintains their shape for longer periods in the game are most likely to win the game. So you're playing a 4-4-2. It doesn't mean the centre-off is always centre-off.
Yeah, as we take a look at the infringement on the play there. Yeah, but you're making the point.
Yeah, I mean, it's as I said, the formation, the shape is most important. So your left back may travel into midfield and becomes your attacking midfielder, while your defensive midfielder may drop into that hole.
That is the Pep Guardiola style, isn't it?
It is. It's a fluent thing, and I embrace that style of football as well.
Well, we're going to take a look at the penalty call there. And based on what we're hearing from our producer, that it may... is that a red card being flashed? It is a red card being flashed.
It's to a... is a coaching staff? Well, that's one of the new rules, that the referee does not have to calm the coaching staff down. He can show a yellow or a red. And it appears that it's a member of the coaching staff that has been given the marching orders.
Anyway, in other news, we're going to see that replay in just a little while. Because,
as we're saying, you know, when we saw it just earlier, it was too far advanced in terms of where the player fell in the box, but it's where the contact was made. And initially, it did look like it was outside the box. So as soon as we can see that...
Granville gets the return ball. And the shot into the side netting is going to be a goal kick to Lennon High. Less than 10 minutes to go in this first half.
But we're seeing a lot of the new rules playing out in this early game, or the first game in the Da Costa Cup. We saw the passes in the box from the goal kick. He saw the wall and no player being able to go to the opposing team.
Clarendon trying to get a second goal before the halftime interval, trying to bounce the ball around nicely in the attacking third, but it didn't work out on that occasion. And long ball is too long. And Alfonso Johnson is never going to reach there over on that far side. Lenny Hyde has a lot of thinking to do.
I guess he'll earn his money today. And maybe his former understudy knows a big thing or two about his tricks.
Well, I tell you what, Lennon, I'm not sure if Lennon is adapting to whatever style Clarendon College has. They're playing their own brand of football. I think it's Clarendon College that probably needs to adapt to what Lennon is bringing to the fore this afternoon.
And good coaches will tell you, you know, it's about your play. You try to execute what you can do well and what you want to do. And your preparation is probably 90% of what you want to do, 10% of the opponent, and how you can thwart whatever strength they have and exploit the weaknesses that may exist in their team. But it's heavily about your team. But so far, Lennon is quite comfortable in this game.
Quite. And here they are coming forward once more. But that final pass has been a little bit disappointing for them. Not being able to go too deep in the attacking third on quite a few occasions so far in this first half. Johnson looking for the return ball, gets it back.
And Lennon seemed to be quite comfortable on the football as well. They pass it around, and what we just saw too is a little bit of what we call in coaching rondo, where you pass it short and you draw opponents in and then you look for the outlet.
It's called Rando.
Rando. Pep Guardiola loves that. Not a training session without Rando.
I'm assuming it's Spanish.
Simply put, it's the man in the middle, but you create different forms of it where your players passing around and one or two players chasing the football in a very small area.
No, I know what it's about, but I'm just wondering about the name of it, Rando. Anyway, it's Clarendon College with the possession. And they're not averse to playing Rando as well.
No.
But they are not averse to the long ball either. Needs a good delivery. Blocked on that occasion. Across by Omar Reed. He won it successfully, did Larmond. No problems there for Javon Grant, the captain.
So far, so good for this Lennon team. But I certainly think with 5 minutes to go for the half time break, I think Thomas will be, of the two coaches, the one that would be more satisfied with the display, especially with the fact that Clarendon are the defending champions and much more is expected of them than this Lennon team.
Less than 5 minutes to go in the first half, but I think that there are going to be at least 3 minutes of stoppages at the end of this half.
A few injuries and a water break.
Mm-hmm. Here's Clarendon College. Granville poking it forward to Nicholson. Gets by one challenge, has he? He goes down again. And it's just outside the box on this occasion.
That was pretty close. I think the challenge, it was inside the box, but...
Yeah, it was inside the box.
I think the player just hit his own leg, his own feet, and fell over. So, looks like a good call there from the referee. But Clarendon seemed to get a... That's where the penalty was given from, or they won the penalty down there, a left side. But I don't think they've been exploiting that area enough. But the few times they've gone that side or in that area, they have gotten some joy.
Javon Grant is down again.
That might be concerning for the Lennon team. That position is a specialist position. And as coaches, we really don't like to make changes in those areas unless forced upon. And we push it as long as we possibly can.
Well, it's known to be a tactic at times, goalkeepers going down and getting some attention from the bench. Because in the meantime, the Lennon players are getting some instructions, well, so to the Clarendon College players, from the coaching staff.
And official, unofficial water break too, because as you said, we're feeling it here, it's scorching hot. But there's the official from the Lennon team that was sent to the stands, and he... So also he made the way, the journey over from Clarendon College, former goalkeeper coach for Clarendon College, and now with Lennon. But his first outing for this season has not gone so well. But these referees are not hesitant in rolling out the new rules. And
so Clarendon College actually took the lead in the third minute of play from the penalty spot, and it was because of this challenge that was made outside of the box. just outside the box, but the referee thought it was inside the box and he gave the penalty. And I mean, it was right on the line. It was pretty close, but you could tell that the challenge came outside the area.
Definitely outside the area. And I have bad memories of those type of things. The team I support outside of Jamaica at World Football was Argentina in 1990. They lost the World Cup to Germany for a penalty awarded outside the box.
Oh, it's not like Argentina haven't won matches and World Cups illegally.
I was hoping that you would forget that.
I was reminded.
The hand of God?
Precisely. Long throw in, headed out.
Well, I guess we have selective memories.
We do. We do. Did you lose a World Cup because of that? Yeah?
Yes, yeah. Argentina lost. Mm. 1990 finals.
Lose one, gain one.
Well, can't complain too much, I guess, then.
No, you can't. Not even a little bit. Nice first touch. Not the best second touch for the pass. Clarendon College trying to keep it simple. Nicholson with the free kick for his team. Just 2 minutes of stoppage time to be played, which is a little bit of a surprise, but it is what it is.
I guess the referee wants to get out of this heat.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time that they got a calculation wrong.
I guess that's what the goalkeeper coach for Lennon is lamenting. But he should have done his homework. This referee, Coombs, in this part of the country, is known as a no-nonsense referee.
Really impressed with Lennon so far. Really have been. And here they are looking for a second goal, and they have a big opportunity to get that too. The cross inside the air, but nobody was attacking there, which was a little bit surprising, to be honest. And that is the end of the first half. The champions held back in the opening game of the season so far. After 45 minutes, we are tied at one apiece here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex in Catherine Hall. As a goal scorer for Clarendon College, Richard King, and Alfonso Johnson with the equalizer for Lennon High. A good finish there by Johnson inside the box. And after 45 minutes, we have seen two goals shared equally between the champions and Lennon.
So in that sense, I think that's what he would have to do to get more time on the ball as well, or make other players come into the game.
Second half underway here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex, and Clarendon College would be thinking of going into second gear now, because they haven't, well, let's just say they've probably stalled. Lennon High in particular wouldn't mind what Clarendon College has offered so far. Haven't really been using their imagination, not to mention properly executing their pre-game plans. We're fortunate to actually get the penalty in the third minute of play. A penalty which they converted to take the lead, as we take a second look at that late challenge coming in. Came in from Deshnal Kiambu.
I think he did get the ball, but
or was it Kyler Williams, in fact?
His follow through really took the player out. But they often say football is a game of two halves. So let's see if one of these two teams, really, or Clarendon College, for the most part, can really turn this one around and not just in the scoreline, but in their display on the field.
Because they are labeled as champions, right? Because they have that tag, the pressure would be on them in particular to impress and to overcome. As Omari takes this free kick floated high inside the box, and there was a coming together inside the area. No infringement, according to the referee.
And that tag comes with added pressure. And what you find is that most persons will not mention the fact that they have lost a number of players, and including their two talisman. But you're champions, so you have to just deal with that.
Yeah, you just have to get on with it. Here's Johnson again. Harassing Richard King, the two goal scorers at it actually. Johnson trying to get by King.
And as expected, he's getting a lot more attention, Johnson. There were two defenders that came across.
It was Williams who was actually brought down there in the end. But free kick to Lennon. Campbell will serve this one up, Deschanel Campbell. Here he is with a free kick, and it's headed wide. It's a goal kick.
The player there with head injury, it seems. But what I have not seen so far in the game from either team is with the set plays, I have not seen much creativity or imagination been brought into play with any of the free kicks that have been taken so far. And sometimes when you're not so fluent in open play, those are the moments where your opportunity will come. And I have not seen much in that area from either team.
You know, your initial point at the start of this broadcast is probably a little bit more telling based on the number of teams in the group and how much time a school would need to gel together and to play that type of football, which would be enough to get out of this group. Now, you mentioned that the lesser teams in this group, the likes of Lennon and
Kellett,
they actually need more time. Lesser teams when you're comparing to the defending champions, Clarendon College, the three other teams, they will actually need more time to get that second spot. One would assume at the start of the season that the three teams will be fighting for that one spot. But based on the scoreline now and the possible results, your statement at the start is even more telling.
It is, because it doesn't give much time, as I said, to recover. You're off to a bad start. The team that loses here is finding themselves not just literally with the fact that they've lost behind, but very little time to try and come back. And as you said, very little time to try and build up a head of steam.
Ashley, again, too long. Goal kick to Clarendon College.
And I suspect it's going to be a lot closer, judging by what I've seen from Lennon and Clarendon here. And I did have a look at Kellett's in pre-season. It's not going to be a runaway for anyone, it seems, in the zone.
Of course, quite a few of the groups would have the advantage of getting one of the third place spots for the next round. Of course, with the amount of teams in this group, that chance has been diminished. Or probably can say that there is actually no chance at all.
None at all. And that's added pressure on these teams. Like I said, there's no doubt in my mind that with a larger group, there is more time to slip up and recover. And with this number of teams, it's really, really, you have to hit the ground running. And like I said, it's not about the performance now in the first game. It's result here in this first game.
Thank you. Granville. Chambers back to Granville. Too much on it. Larmond. Whipped in by Omar Reed. Still not cleared properly. A chance for Clarendon College. Still not cleared properly. Granville's effort. Charged down. No problems there for Javon Grant. Couple opportunities there for Clarendon College. They didn't have a lot of chances in the first half. So I guess you can say that things are looking up for the champions so far in the second half.
Looking a little bit better. And after that excitement, I've always said to players, there needs to be end product after the fanciness. Whether it's a defense splitting pass, a shot on goal, a goal, an assist, but it cannot just be for that. The fanciness.
It can't just be that alone.
That alone.
You want to continue that shot and show the bad pass, right?
Exactly.
Well, he's already on the score sheet, Richard King, so.
Well, his team is still locked at 1-1. And I'm pretty sure they'd want to go ahead goal in this one. I think there's still time in this game, but based on what we've seen, I think we can't stick by a notion that this contest this year was not going to be a 6-0 or a 5-1.
Unless something dramatic really happens. Either way.
True. I did hear at halftime that the assistant coach for Clarendon College was saying they were contemplating two changes. I didn't notice any change.
No, it remains a contemplation.
It has to come to reality soon, because what we're getting here from Clarendon College is not what we've come to expect. I think that's where Lennon has been doing well, in the middle of the park. Clarendon has not been allowed to have their own way.
Can't keep it in play, can he? No.
So if I was Coach Thomas, I would be quite expecting or urging on my midfield for more of the same, because it has not been easy since the first 5 minutes of the game for Clarendon College to find their way through. It's quite risky play there from the central defender. I mean, you had two Lennon players bearing down on you. And as a defender, you seek to take them on in your defensive third.
Referee saying play on. Desmond Campbell is looking for the free kick. You know, in previous years, we've seen champions not get maximum points from their first game. We did see it last year between Jamaica College and Hydell. As a matter of fact, Jamaica College would have been, because of the fact that they won five straight, they would have been the main example for the past 2 years. But they haven't really started like a house on fire a few of those seasons. I think, was it Camperdown that they drew with at one stage? And of course they drew with Hydell.
But
although, to be honest, this is the first time that the first and second seed in the Dacosta Cup group will be playing each other first up.
Okay.
So it would be, based on paper, more competitive.
Based on paper, yes, last season it wasn't competitive. But yes, with the exodus of the players from Clarendon College and Lennon retaining all of 8 of their players, then I guess you expected the margin to shrink. And so much closer contest between the two teams. Yes, you've seen even on world stage where defending champions in the World Cup or even European Championship don't hit the ground running. But you can see the quality, they have good qualities in there. It's left to be seen with Clarendon College, with the loss of the players, whether or not these players coming in now would be able to lift their game.
Corner kick taken short. Reed couldn't get it past the first defender. Try to get it going. Clarendon College through David Chambers. Now in the middle of the park and put over to the left hand side now. And he goes down inside the box. Referee doesn't pay him any attention. Chambers, Granville, trying to make his way between a couple of defenders, wasn't the wisest choice. And losing the ball there was stupid. Granville. Clarendon College couldn't capitalize there. Lennon will go the other way though. Hall. There's a lot of space, and he goes into that space. There's a whistle on the play. And the yellow card is shown.
I think he impeded the defender from making the challenge, and as such, gave his teammate an advantage. Dare we say it, the defender, or goal scorer for Clarendon College, King, was going across to make the challenge when he blocked his path. And so for sure, it's worthy of the yellow card. He certainly knew what he was doing.
Well, the goal scorers have been at it in the second half. Johnson getting the yellow card there. I'm not even sure that was necessary because I felt that he was almost through Deshnell Campbell.
Yes, it seems like King was a bit late.
Exactly.
In closing him down or getting to the point where he's going to challenge him. So maybe what he did was to prevent his team an opportunity to develop a good attack.
Javon Bryan comes on. Dante Atkinson also comes on, the number 17 for Lennon, coming all the way from Kingston High. Dante Atkinson, the number 17. So Atkinson coming on for Glaives, in fact.
Well, it is Lennon who blinks first. That gives you an idea of the intention of Coach Thomas. Maybe he sensed that he could get something out of this tie for the first time in a long while. And as such, he's been proactive.
Yeah, for the first time in about 3 years, actually. Well, Clarendon College blinked right after.
Well, Wilkes coming out, and he was expected to carry and shoulder the load up front for this Clarendon College team, not able to replicate, and it was a big task for him to replicate the works of Daly and Walker.
Thank you.
David had a situation where the referee had to get out of the way. Now, had the ball hit the referee and gone to the opponent, the referee would be obliged to stop the game and give that ball back to the team as a part of some of the rules being rolled out. So the teacher and the student here locked in a very intense tactical battle.
Students seeing a lot of details in this contest, apparently.
I guess that's how you get the changing of the guard sometimes.
Christopher Graham, the number 21 for Clarendon College. Here's the movement again, but goalkeeper and captain saw it all the way. So they have changed up front, Clarendon College, with the introduction of Graham. And 63 minutes gone, and Lennon High still hustling their way through. Haven't really shown a lot of signs of fatigue in this second half. And the heat can be draining.
It can be, but we're safe to say that the pace of this game has pretty much been maintained throughout. It's nothing. It hasn't gone up a notch at all.
Yeah, it's a little above pedestrian, in fact.
and that's the pace we've seen pretty much throughout this encounter. And there we see the goal kick being passed in the box. And normally it would have come out of the box before. And I guess sometimes you draw pressure onto yourself.
But here's a chance for Lennon. Is there a free kick there? Referee says no.
So there we have it now, where the ball hit the referee. Immediately he has to stop the game. He will do a drop ball to the team that hit the ball against him. And no opponent can be next to the player that he's going to drop the ball to. Okay. So again, the new rules being implemented here.
So the referee is not a part of the play anymore?
No.
As was
no,
the case in the
no.
past.
But I thought there I saw a teammate beside him. I think it should have been a case where it's only the player that he's going to drop the ball to.
This shot. Ambitious effort, to say the least.
But I think he did well, because there was no Lennon player close by.
Jaheen Rose getting ready to come on for Clarendon College. Andre Nicholson has been taken out. No glory for him in this game. Here's Lennon. So that could have been costly there. Oh, Lennon running back. And the clearance, yeah, I guess you'd have to give them credit for that, was made in the end.
I guess as we always say as coaches, you have to just clear your lines sometimes when you're under pressure and just reorganize yourself.
This one is driven inside and just over the head of the oncoming attacker. Sheldon Smart was there.
As you can see there, that's where I think Lennon has done really well in terms of stopping this Clarendon College team going forward.
Lennon, here's the effort that is charged down. Johnson, again giving a little bit more space.
Here you have it again in the middle of the park, teaming up quite well there, the goal scorer with his other midfield player.
Harrison couldn't quite find Jerome Williams. He looks to be in some pain.
His thigh or his groin area that he's holding on to.
Well, it's probably a dead leg actually, based on how he's reacting. If it was a groin injury, he wouldn't be doing that. Yeah, it's probably cramp actually. Muscles tightening up, it seems.
He might have had his foot stepped on there.
Omar Reed has been the provider of a number of the free kicks and corner kicks and crosses for Clarendon College, so he's been instrumental to their attacks. There's another water break being taken.
But looking at the Clarendon coaching staff, I think if they look at the game, it's been very difficult going through the middle of the park with how this Lennon team sets up, and the two wide player gets quite narrow in when they're out of attack, and we'd want to feel that maybe their best chance would have been to use those wide areas, because even so, as much as the penalty appeared to have the incident that resulted in the penalty appeared to have occurred out of the box, it definitely came down from the flank area. And so Clarendon might be better served to have their attack going down the flanks.
Two goals in this game so far. Clarendon College opening the scoring in the third minute of play from the penalty spot through Richard King, and Lennon responding about 10 minutes later through Alphonse Johnson. And Lennon again trying to break through.
I've seen a number of that from this Clarendon College team, that the balls, the long balls that they seek to go over the top, just been over purchased in terms of its execution. We've definitely not seen a lot of goal mouth activity in this one so far in the second half.
Well, that was much of the vote, nothing. Clarendon College with the possession in a dangerous position here. And the shot is tipped over in the end by Javon Grant. Looked a little bit innocuous. There wasn't a lot of power behind it. But Grant decided not to take any chances in trying to catch it and fired it over the bar.
Looked like one that was looping. Dipped at the last minute. Seemed to have taken a deflection, apparently. And that made it a little bit more complicated.
Lennon player is getting treatment inside his own penalty area. Number of these players suffering from cramp.
So you expect that if you don't hydrate yourself or rehydrate yourself in this condition.
And it is one of their center backs getting some attention and will have to leave the field for this corner kick coming up. Can Clarendon College capitalize? Corner kick to Clarendon College, and well, it'll come in now. This one is headed wide of the target. Earl Simpson here from the back, making connection with that one and putting it wide.
Was again a free header, and Lennon for the second time around. We've seen that from Clarendon College. Would be mindful of that.
Well, here's a shot that did he take a deflection? Well, Roger Granville was looking for that deflection to bail him out, but the shot was well wide of the target.
Definitely. Early on, we saw the Lennon player having to leave the field, having gone down with cramps, and we saw moments before that. Another player going down, quite a few of the players going down with cramps. So there's a number of stoppages taking place in this second half. It's interesting to see what the referee will add to it. In the first half, he only added two, and we thought there were more minutes to be added on.
Well, there's going to be more stoppages.
So we'll see whether or not what he comes up with.
He probably just add one more minute. If the first half is anything to go by. We haven't had a lot of shots on target, two apiece. Clarendon College with more efforts, though. And that would have come in the second half.
With those stats, you'd want to see Lennon is more clinical in terms of their efforts and what they have converted.
Well, Clarendon, they haven't done anything from open play.
It's true.
Their goal coming from the penalty spot.
And wanted to say that the goalkeeper from Lennon, Grant, had to make just now. Clarendon was helped out by deflection.
When we have seen deflections win matches and trophies, so it won't be the first time.
And based on this encounter, I guess Clarendon or Lennon will be most happy anyhow the next goal comes.
Clarendon College would probably blame rust. I guess both players, or both sets of players, would say rust would be a factor. But I would say that Lennon not being able to execute in the attacking third would be more of a factor, because they do look clean when they come forward at times, and here they come again, and there you go with the with that final pass not being an accurate one.
Yes, it has been the hallmark of the second half with Lennon. They have transitioned from defense to midfield, but when it gets into that final third, the quality of that final pass leaves a lot to be desired of. I think for both teams, and reflected in the 1-1 scoreline, the quality in that final third.
You have a chance until the 85th minute to vote for your MVP, and you can log in on watch.sportsmax.tv to cast your vote for the player of the game. You'll see the options there available. Having said that, anyone stands out for you, Dwight?
I will use up my time up to the 85th minute too.
Tyreek Robinson comes on for Lennon High, formerly of Edith Dalton James. Let's see what he brings to the fore for Lennon. Javon Bryan. This could be an opportunity for Lennon. I'm not sure why he decided to take the shot there. He had other options, and he was reaching for the ball behind him, so it was going to be difficult for him to generate any power on it.
Always difficult, because he started with his back to goal. Mm-hmm. Then he had to shovel and shoot. It's always difficult technique to master. And he may have had runners left and right of him.
Dante Atkinson returns.
Then again,
Clarendon College is about to make their final substitution. Just to confirm that just now Ricardo Beckford came on for Omar Reed, who had received a knock just a few minutes before. Then Steve McCutty is getting set to come on, number 29. And this is an attacking change, as he has replaced Jalen Larmon.
I think that is a clear indication that Coach Hyde wants to get the 3 points here today in this very small group of four. He's trying to get that go-ahead goal to see if he can walk away with the 3 points. That would definitely put him in a very good advantageous position, because of, as we keep saying, the number of teams in this group. You want to get ahead pretty early. There we see the referee Coombs. He is a no-nonsense referee. You see him telling the players to go away. Decision is final.
Clarendon College trying to press. Took too long to pass the ball. And Lennon guilty of the same thing. And so Clarendon College with the possession can make them pay. I believe that he himself took long to make that final pass to Christopher Graham. Here they come again. Lennon handling this one easily. Clarendon College though more forthright. McCarty overran the ball.
I think in this very first wave of attack, the ball should have come across to the substitute coming on there. For Clarendon College, he was in a wide open space, similar to the position that Johnson found himself in for Lennon when he converted the equalizer.
Pass come on for Lennon, the number 9. So Lennon as well with the attacking change, and I believe that Lennon has one more up their sleeve if they choose to use it.
Coach Hyde, he has played all his cards.
Well, I'm not sure if any of the changes have been effective so far.
Well, if anything, we can see with Clarendon with the last couple of changes they made, we saw a little rise in the tempo and more activity in the final third, looking a little bit more purposeful.
Seeing Kingston College players in the background preparing for their game, which is up next. Manny Cup opening game at the Montego Bay Sports Complex.
And with the tempo in this game, we can only expect it to rise when the KC takes the field against Excelsior.
This may be difficult. Not quite. Prince Daniel Smith immediately bowling it out. McCarty looking for options, plays it inside. The passes haven't been 100% accurate. Here's Clarendon College though, looking for more space. Still has time, lays it across to McCarty. Oh goodness me, he passed it to the keeper.
It was a perfect opportunity for Clarendon College to go ahead. It was a good move. And the power played, he found himself in acres of space again on that right side. He just could not execute.
Jamari Howell playing further upfield. McCarty, can he get there? McCarty on his left foot trying to get by the defender, couldn't. Lennon defending all their worth at the moment. I'm wondering if they can hit Clarendon College on the counter.
I think based on Clarendon's approach to the game at this stage, they're right for that.
Richard King in the wars again.
Just
against Deschanel Campbell.
It's a knee into the player. That can be quite painful at times.
Yeah, I'm sure he probably has a dead leg because of it.
He do get that problem from the knee.
Campbell will be off the field for a bit, getting a bit more treatment. Apparently the assistant coach got a yellow card just now.
Oh, it's a good thing Lennon is managing to keep their 11 players on the field, but as for their coaching staff, they're not managing to do so.
Yep. Lennon making their final change. And Tyrese Green has come on for Lennon. I wonder if he came on for Deschanel Campbell. Yeah, so he has come on for Campbell. It's again, the long ball of field. Well, let's just say that Earl Simpson knows what he's doing. The fans have voted for Alphonso Johnson as the MVP of this game. And I really can't blame them, can I?
Definitely. I had that thought in the head based on a game where it could be difficult to find. But because of how he made space and then executed that finish for the equalizing goal, I think we can't have any complaint with that. I definitely would go with him as well.
There could be a twist in the tail, though. Clarendon College trying to press. Lennon defending stubbornly. Keep in mind that technically this is Clarendon College's home game. If I'm incorrect, you can correct me. So Lennon actually has a home game in hand against CC, and that could be interesting.
Based on what they've seen here, I'm pretty sure they'll be thinking that that is an opportunity that they could just get the better of this Clarendon College team.
I'm going to assume, though, that Clarendon College will get better than that effort.
The other teams in this group will be thinking it could just be their year to come out of this zone, apart from these two teams.
Clarendon College. Oh, that almost went through. Here's a chance. Forced to go wide, and the shot is high. Just 4 minutes of stoppages apparently will be played. It's like the referees are saying, you know what, the quicker the better, as we take a look at that last effort, which there's nothing to write home about.
It's good defending there. He showed the attacker down the line and narrowed the angle for the shot, made it very difficult for him to execute or get a shot on target. That was very good defending there. But we've come to see over the years where opening games are one-sided, and you know, it's a favorite for the competition come up against a minor team, and you have just a runaway winner. For this one, it is quite the opposite here. We've had not a lot of goals in it, but it doesn't mean that the game was not intriguing. It was a real tactical battle here. and we've had a much closer contest than we've seen over the years in the opening game.
So we're almost midway through the time added for stoppages. And there's a corner kick to Clarendon College. They have put five players inside the box, and there's another bit of stoppage to look forward to as the referee runs across to this near side to speak to the assistant referee, and a yellow card will come out, and it's going to be shown to Tajay Williams. Must be the second time I've called his name the entire match, Tajay Williams. So he's had a quiet game. Played for Excelsior last year. A player who has come from the East. Paul Bogle, in fact, the year before. It's going to be another corner kick to Clarendon College. So they're trying to apply the pressure in the closing stages of this game. This one is taken short. Let's see if it's still effective. Was he coming from an offside position? Yes, he was.
It's the first time that they tried to do something different. I was about to say, with a set piece in a game this close, it would have been good to see a little bit more creativity from both teams when they get these set piece opportunities. But that was not the case today. And that is something that both these two teams will seek to improve on as the tournament goes on.
Lennon High still has the likes of Tyrese Harrison to come into this starting lineup. Of course, Tyreek is his twin brother. Tyrese is a younger one, but he actually broke his foot at the start of the summer. He has begun some light training with the team, but obviously Lennon would not take a chance with playing him today. So Tyreek and Tyrese, 16-year-old twins for Lennon High. Just Tyreek playing here this afternoon.
However, if things don't improve, I think they might be forced to bring him in to bring some quality into the team, because, like I said, not much time for these teams, the teams in this zone to really amount of recovery if they fall too far behind. And I suspect with this player going down, we're going to have more stoppage time added in stoppage time.
Yeah, and with the fact that Leonard has the ball, it may be the last play of the game. John Thomas would be pleased with what has taken place so far.
I would agree with you with that, because I guess before the season starts, as coaches, you tend to look at your group and you pencil out where you think you will get your maximum points and where it might be difficult, or you possibly could drop maximum points as well. And I guess against the Clarendon team, he would probably think, yes, this is going to be a difficult game. So I think he would be pleased with the outcome if it stays this way.
Free kick for Lennon. I think they have to take it over.
No, I think that's the end of the game.
No, that's the end of the game. Well, he's obviously seen enough, referee Coombs. At the end of 90 minutes, the champions have been held here at the Montego Bay Sports Complex in the opening game of the schoolboy football season, in the Da Costa Cup in particular. Lennon High, who were battered last season over the course of two games by 11-1, held on to Clarendon College in no uncertain terms, coming up with the equalizer in that first half. Equalizer coming from Alfonso Johnson in the 13th minute after Richard King had scored from the penalty spot, a controversial penalty. But at the end of 90 minutes, they shared the points in this one. Clarendon College won.